So in the last class on unit 6, we have discussed about the RC oscillators, and in particular we have considered two types of RC oscillator, namely the RC phase shift oscillator and the Weinbridge oscillator. And the basic criteria for an oscillator circuit which we have established in the last class is that this Barkhausen condition, that means the loop gain should be equal to minus 1 TS, as we have mentioned in the last class. Now, in this particular lecture, we will be talking about LC oscillator. This is another type of oscillator which is used for the generation of sinusoidal signal. Now, to start with, we have two different LC oscillators in our syllabus. One is the Hartley oscillator, and the second one is the Colpitts oscillator. Now, both of these two different LC oscillators can be described by means of a unified diagram. So let me start with the diagram first and find out the condition for which this LC oscillator will provide a sinusoidal signal of a particular frequency. And then we will one by one draw the individual circuit for Hartley and Colpitts. So as you understand, we have an amplifier circuit. Let us consider we have a single stage common emitter amplifier. So I am representing this amplifier by means of a black box, single stage C amplifier. So as you understand, from the input to the output, there will be 180 degree phase difference. So this is the output terminal of this feed network. So we must have back network. Now in case of LC oscillator, the back network is consisting of L and C, inductor and capacitor. Now, in order to draw the unified diagram, let me have a circuit like this. Suppose these are the two reactants. And there is another reactance over here. So this point is grounded. This point is also grounded. And the feedback signal is obtained from this particular terminal, and which is fed at the input of the feed network. So back network consists of three frequency selective reactances. So there is no externally connected input signal. So three frequency selective reactants over there. So let me name, like, suppose this one is JX1, this one is say JX2, and this one is say JX3. This is the output signal V0, and this has been the feedback signal. Let it be VF. So this is the unified diagram for LC oscillator. So as you understand, both L and C, if I consider inductor, so for an inductor, the reactance is given by J omega L. So this is the inductor XL, if I write, that is nothing but J omega L. And for a capacitor, the corresponding reactance XC is given by 1 upon J omega C, which is nothing but minus J by omega C. So I can always represent minus J by omega C. So I can always represent this inductor and capacitor by means of J times some X1, where X1, X2, X3, so these are the variables corresponding to the value of the frequency and the value of the inductor or capacitor. So X1, X2, X3, these are the real numbers, and we have J outside. Now this is the amplifier circuit, which is providing a gain of AV, for example. The gain of the amplifier is AV. So if I just want to observe the output side of the amplifier, how does it look like, the output side? In the output side, you must appreciate that there is internally connected, I mean, voltage signal like this, and there is a series resistance, which is nothing but the output resistance of the transistor itself. So either you consider this current source and output resistance in shunt, or voltage source and output resistance in series. So same thing. So far we have considered this model, that we have this GM V pi, we have GM V pi, and in shunt with that we have R naught. So some current source and some output resistance in shunt path. So this is equivalent to having a voltage source along with an output resistance R naught over here. Now, because of the presence of this output resistance R naught, this output voltage V naught and the internally generated voltage every time is V in, so they are not same. Since we have the output resistance R naught over here, so this V naught and every time is V in, these two values are not same. Now you have to identify the condition for which this particular circuit will oscillate at any particular frequency. Now, once again, as you understand, there is no externally connected input signal provided to this particular oscillator circuit or to this particular feed network. Output voltage is being fed to the input of this back network. This is the back network comprising of these three elements, JX1, JX2, and JX3. So the output voltage is being fed to the input of the back network, and the back network generates some feedback voltage, and this feedback voltage is connected at the input of the feed network only. So as a matter of fact, there is no externally connected Vin. In fact, this Vin is nothing but VF. So what you need to ensure is that whenever the signal is traversing from this end through the back network, and once again it comes back over here, the total phase difference must be equal to 360 degrees. So that you have to ensure that the signal traversing from this end, traveling to this back network, and once again whenever the signal comes out of the back network and it is once again fed to the feed network, the total phase difference should be 360 degrees, and the Barkhausen condition has to be established. Now to analyze this circuit, or now to find out the condition, let me consider that the current that is flowing through this path, let it be I1, this current is I1, and suppose this current be I2. So total current, if the total current is I over here, so which is equal to I1 plus I2. So now I have to find out the individual value for I1 and I2. So over here, the total impedance seen by this I1 is nothing but JX3. So this is nothing but V naught upon J times X1 plus X3. And I2 is nothing but V naught by J times X2. Then what about the total current? Total current is the summation of these two current. There is another way to represent the total current. The total current that is flowing over here, so let me go to the next slide. The total current, so I can once again redraw the output side. The output side, you have a circuit like this. You have R naught over here. And the circuit looks something like that. There is JX2 over here and JX1 and JX3 in series over here. And from this point, we are taking the feedback VF. So let it be JX2. This one is JX1. This one is JX3. And as I've already mentioned, this point is the V naught. So this one is AV times V in, internally generated voltage signal, AV times V in, and this one is R naught. So the current that is flowing through this part, that is I. So this I can be written like AV times V in minus V naught divided by R naught. which is equal to V naught by jx1 plus x3 plus V naught by jx2. So if I just simplify this one, we find that AV V in by R naught is equal to V naught by R naught plus V naught jx2 times x1 plus x3. Then you have in the numerator x1 plus x2 plus x3. So in other words, AV times V in is nothing but V naught plus V naught into R naught into x1 plus x2 plus x3. Upon j into x2, x1 plus x3. So this is the expression which involves or which makes V in as a function of V naught only. So now, what about Vf? The feedback voltage Vf is nothing but V naught by x1 plus x3 into x1. This is the expression for the feedback voltage, V naught upon x1 plus x3 multiplied with x1. So now if I want to represent V naught as a function of V in, so what I can do is I can take this one common, AV times V in. V naught outside. So you have jx2 into x1 plus x3 plus r0 into x1 plus x2 plus x3. So the whole thing is multiplied with V0. Whole thing is multiplied with V naught. Let me check once again. We have AV V in by R naught is equal to V naught by R naught plus V naught by this jx2 into x1 plus x3. And in the numerator, you have x1 plus x2 plus x3. So AV V in is equal to, so if you multiply with R naught, so you have V naught over here, then V naught into R naught in this one. And if I take V naught outside, so it will become jx2 into x1 plus x3 multiplied with this one. The numerator you have this one, r0 into x1 plus x2 plus x3 plus j into x1 plus x3. So now, if I put the value over here, the Vf, we have got like Vf is equal to V0 by x1 plus x3 into x1. So this is equal to your AV times V in. This is equal to AV times V in. So V naught by X1 plus X3, I can easily write like V naught by X1 plus X3, I can easily write like AV times V in into J x2 divided by jx2 into x1 plus x3 plus r0 into x1 plus x2 plus x3. So this is the value for V naught upon X1 plus X3. Now we have to multiply this with X1. So you have X1 over here. So this relates Vf as a function of Vin. So what about the loop gain? So the loop gain Vf upon Vin, if I just consider this one, so it is coming like J times AV times X1, X2 divided by J times X2 into X1 plus X3 plus R0 into X1 plus X2 plus X3. Now we have to make sure that this entire thing must be a real function, I mean a real number. However, you have J in the numerator and in the denominator you have a complex function like this. Now to satisfy the Barkhausen condition, this is nothing but the ratio between Vf to Vin. What is Vf to Vin? That ratio, if I just once again go back over here, so Vf is nothing but the signal which is being fed to the input of the feed network, and assuming that this input is nothing but Vin. So Vf by Vin, if I just consider that ratio, so you must ensure that this Vf by Vin, that ratio must be equal to 1. There should not be any phase difference and there should not be any gain, so that the Barkhausen condition is satisfied and we have a sustained oscillation. So now, in order to make sure that this particular thing, this particular ratio provides a value of unity without any phase difference, so the condition which has to be satisfied over here is that this R0 into X1 plus X2 plus X3, that thing must be equal to 0. Under this condition, this J will be cancelled out both from the numerator as well as from the denominator. Now, R0 is non-zero. So therefore, this X1 plus X2 plus X3, the summation of these three must be equal to 0. So to satisfy the Barkhausen condition, X1 plus X2 plus X3 must be equal to 0, since R0 is non-zero. So then under this condition, it is reduced to, in the numerator you have J AV X1 into X2, and in the denominator you have J X2 into X1 plus X3. So this can be simplified like, in the numerator you have AV, X2 can be cancelled out, AV times X1 divided by you have X1 plus X3. So what is X1 plus X3? Under this condition, X1 plus X3 is minus X2. So you have minus X2 over here. So this is nothing but minus AV times X1 by X2. Now, since we are considering a single stage common emitter amplifier, so the gain must be negative. Gain must be negative. I mean, there is a phase difference of 180 degree between the input and output. So AV, I have considered over here like AV times Vin. If the input is Vin, the output is AV times Vin. But remember, if I consider a single stage common emitter amplifier, then the value of AV must be negative. So if I take into account that part, then minus AV is always positive. So minus AV is positive, and you are left with mod AV times X1 by X2. So ultimately, the thing is coming like, this entire thing is coming like mod AV times X1 by X2. Now, in order to ensure that this entire thing is equal to 1, so X1 and X2 must be of the same type. So as I've already mentioned, this X1, X2, and X3, they are either inductor or capacitor. Now, the satisfaction of the Barkhausen condition dictates that this X1 and X2 must be of the same type. Now, if both X1 and X2, if they are inductor, if both of them are inductor, then we'll be having what is known as Hartley oscillator. Hartley oscillator. And if X1 and X2, both of them are capacitor, Then you have what is known as Colpitts oscillator. Then what about the third element, x3? As you already know that x1 plus x2 plus x3 must be equal to 0. X1 plus x2 plus x3 must be equal to 0. Now, if x1 and x2 are of the same type, then to satisfy the Barkhausen condition, x3 must be of opposite type. That means if x1 and x2 are inductor, then x3 must be capacitor. So in that case, we have x3 as capacitor. X3 is equal to C. And here you have x3 is equal to L. Now let us find out the condition, or let us find out the oscillation frequency for Hartley oscillator. For Hartley oscillator, x1 and x2, they are inductor, and x3 is a capacitor. So accordingly, you can find out the value of the oscillation frequency. If you put the value over here, you'll find that the oscillation frequency over here is coming like omega is equal to 1 by L effective or let me just put the value over here. So x1 will become omega times L1, x2 will become omega times L2, and x3 is nothing but minus 1 by omega times C3. So putting the value over here, we find that omega L1 plus omega L2 is equal to 1 by omega C3. In other words, omega L1 plus L2 is equal to 1 by omega C3. So from which we can have omega square is given by 1 upon L1 plus L2 into C3. So omega, the oscillation frequency, the angular oscillation frequency is given by 1 upon root over of L effective into C3, where L effective is the effective inductor that is equal to L1 plus L2. Or if you want to find out the Hertz frequency, so the Hertz frequency is given by 1 by 2 pi root over of L effective into C3. So this is the scenario for the Hartley oscillator, where both of them, I mean x1 and x2 are inductor, and the third element is the capacitor. Similarly, if I want to calculate the same thing for an Colpitts oscillator, so for an Colpitts oscillator, the condition being the same, x1 plus x2 plus x3 equal to 0. Now for Colpitts oscillator, we have x1 is equal to minus 1 upon omega C1, x2 is equal to minus 1 upon omega C2, and x3 is equal to omega L3. So putting the value, I find omega L3 is equal to 1 by omega C1 plus 1 by omega C2. So that is equal to C1 plus C2 divided by omega C1 C2. So omega square is coming like 1 upon C effective into L3, where C effective, the effective capacitance, is nothing but C1 C2 upon C1 plus C2. So omega is equal to 1 by root over of L3 into C effective. Or if I want to find out the corresponding Hertz frequency, the Hertz frequency is nothing but 1 by 2 pi root over of L3 into C effective. Now by making the C effective value close to few picofarads, you can attain the oscillation frequency as high as a few tens of megahertz, at least few 1 to 2 megahertz. You can achieve an oscillation frequency within that particular range. However, you have seen that when RC oscillator, as you have discussed in the last class, this RC phase shift oscillator and the Weinberg oscillator, the oscillation frequency which can be obtained using those RC oscillators is limited to few hundreds of kilohertz at max. Now we can enhance the oscillation frequency by using this LC oscillator to some extent in the order of few megahertz. Now so far in this discussion, we have only considered the unified diagram of this LC oscillator. We have just considered this one, this amplifier, as a black box. Now we can develop each of these two amplifiers, I mean oscillator circuits, this Hartley oscillator and Colpitts oscillator, by using a single stage common emitter amplifier in this particular black box. Now to start with, let us first consider the Colpitts oscillator. Now we have single stage common emitter amplifier consisting of a voltage divider bias like this. Single stage common emitter amplifier, we have voltage divider bias, and there is a collector resistance RC, and emitter resistance is there. Mite bit is bypassed by means of bypass capacitor. So let me name this one is R1, this one is R2. This is the collector resistance RC. This one is the emitter resistance RE. This one is the bypass capacitor CE. This is the supply line, it is VCC. Now this being the output terminal, now we have, so we are now going to design the Colpitts oscillator. So for Colpitts oscillator, you do have two capacitors and one inductor. If you can remember the unified diagram, once again, if I just go back over here, so you must have two capacitors, this X1 and X2 must be capacitor and this X3 must be inductor. So X3 is inductor, so I can have an inductor over here in the form of L3. And we have a capacitor in the form of C1. And this capacitor C2. So this is C2. This one is L3. This is C1. And the feedback is provided from this particular terminal. So there is no externally connected input signal. So this is directly connected over here. So let me connect it directly and let us see what happens. I may connect it directly, this terminal. So this is the feedback voltage which I am feeding back at the input of the amplifier itself. This is the output V0. Now, as soon as you make any attempt to connect this terminal directly to the base, now what happens? DC wise, these two potential being the same, because in the low frequency, if I consider the frequency operation equal to 0 hertz, that means under DC condition, this inductor will act as a short circuit. The reactance provided by the inductor is equal to omega times L. Now for omega equal to 0 at DC frequency, this will act as short circuited. So therefore, at DC wise, this collector terminal and base, they are short circuited. And under this condition, you don't require any additional resistance R1 and R2 to bias the base, because already it is getting the bias through this collector terminal. So under this condition, you can eliminate this R1 and R2. Or if you want to ensure that these two terminals, that means base and collector, they are isolated under DC condition, then what you can do is you can add or you can insert one DC blocking capacitor over here of sufficiently high value, so that even under the DC condition, this base and collector, they are not DC wise connected. However, the value of this DC blocking capacitor should be very high as compared to C1 and C2, so that it cannot interact with the oscillation frequency. But if you don't have this capacitor over here, if you want to eliminate the capacitor, if I directly connect over here, so under this condition, you'll find that the need for these two resistances, R1 and R2, is not there, because DC wise, it is getting the connection from the collector, or you can also think that it is equivalent to something like that. That means this inductor is connected between this base and collector, just like this, like a bridge. From this point to that point, the inductor is connected. So this is the circuit diagram for an Hartley oscillator. So let me, Colpitts oscillator. So let me write down the name over here, Colpitts oscillator. And the oscillation frequency, we have already derived. This is like 1 upon 2 pi root over C1 C2 upon C1 plus C2 into L3. Now let us consider the design of Hartley oscillator. So we will start with the same common emitter model, single stage common emitter amplifier, which provides 180 degree phase difference between the input and its output. So the additional 180 degree phase difference is being provided by the feedback network, so that the total phase difference is 360 degree or 0 degree. So we do have a similar common emitter stage, just like Colpitts oscillator. So this is grounded. Now to increase the stability, we have to introduce this bypass capacitor over here. But remember, the value of this bypass capacitor is pretty large, in the order of hundreds of microfarads. So that it must not interfere with these capacitors C1 and C2. Typical value of C1 and C2 is in the order of few picofarads or in the range of nanofarads. So they are normally higher as compared to, the CE, a bypass capacitor and this collector capacitor, this coupling capacitor, these capacitors are typically higher as compared to those C1 and C2, which are used for oscillation. So this is the supply line PCC. Now, for an Hartley oscillator, we do have inductor. Two inductor and one capacitor. So we have two inductor. So this one is L2. This one is L2. And we do have inductor, another inductor L1 over here. This one is C3. Now the feedback is taken from this terminal and it is connected over here directly at the base of the single stage common emitter amplifier. Now what happens for this particular topology? So this one is the output V0. So this point is basically the DC ground terminal, DC ground. Now what happens at low frequency? At low frequency or at zero frequency, when you are considering the DC signal during the biasing period, this L1 inductor, this inductor this inductor L1, it will make this particular terminal DC ground. Why? Because this terminal is a DC ground, and at zero frequency or low frequency, this L1 will act as a short circuit. So it will make this terminal to DC ground, and eventually what happens? This base potential will become zero. So this will create a problem for the proper functioning of the amplifier, because you are not getting the corresponding bias. So what is done? Once again, just like the previous case, you can also insert one capacitor over here, which will prevent. You can also insert a capacitor over here, which will prevent the potential at the base terminal to go to zero at DC frequency. Because at DC frequency, this inductor will act as short circuited. And as a matter of fact, these two terminals will be having the same potential. So this is the DC ground. So this particular point will also become DC ground. So the base will be having no bias. So to prevent that, the capacitor is connected over here. Otherwise, what you can do is, there are two DC ground. What you can do is you can just eliminate these two DC ground. Rather, you can connect them together. And here you connect a capacitor. So this is a DC blocking capacitor. It has nothing to do with the oscillation. Typically large. This DC blocking capacitor, let it be like C DC blocking. So let it be like CC or so DC blocking capacitor. So this particular terminal will be at AC ground, and this particular terminal will be at DC ground. So even at zero frequency under DC condition, since we have connected the capacitor over here, this DC blocking capacitor CC over here, so it will prevent this particular terminal, this base potential, to be at zero. It will prevent of making the base potential at zero by virtue of this DC blocking capacitor. So by means of which you can once again modify the circuit for this Hartley oscillator. So let me write down the name. So this is the diagram for Hartley oscillator. I mean the BJT implementation of Hartley oscillator, in which case you have two inductors L1 and L2 and one capacitor C3 for its operation. And as you have already mentioned, the corresponding oscillation frequency omega is given by 1 upon root over L1 plus L2 into C3, from which you can derive that the Hertz frequency is given by 1 by 2 pi root over L1 plus L2 into C3. Now by selecting appropriate value for L and C, you can achieve the oscillation frequency F0 to be as high as few tens of megahertz, so that you can achieve higher oscillation, oscillation at higher frequency using this LC oscillator circuit. However, if I once again go back to the actual condition, the Barkhausen condition, once again you'll see that this Barkhausen condition, let us take this one for example, this omega L1, omega L2, and 1 by omega C3, minus 1 by omega C3. The condition is that X1 plus X2 plus X3 must be equal to 0, in which case the Barkhausen condition is established. Now, either for Hartley or for Colpitt, you'll see that this condition is satisfied only for a single value of omega. So omega squared equal to 1 by 1 upon L1 plus L2 into C3. So this is true only for a single value of angular frequency omega. So that's why this Barkhausen condition is satisfied only for a single value of omega. So I can say that this oscillator, either Hartley or Colpitt, so they will generate a monotone frequency signal. That means over here, the output signal, suppose you can have a sinusoidal signal like this. Now, there could have been other frequency as well. This particular network might generate the other frequency components apart from this omega naught, what we have already described, this omega naught that is equal to 1 by the root over of LC. So apart from this particular frequency, so other frequency will also be generated over here, but the signals at those frequency will not be obtained at the output because of the fact that the sustained oscillation is not guaranteed for other frequency. Or in other words, I can say that this Barkhausen condition is not at all satisfied for the other frequency. So only one frequency will be obtained over here. So we'll be getting only a sinusoidal signal at the output of this LC oscillator, just like an RC oscillator, what we have discussed in the last class. So with this, let me conclude the discussion on LC oscillator.